Hallelujah. We're so grateful to be up today, to be able to bless the name of the Lord. I know you at home, but come on, get out your bed and lift your hands and give him glory. We serve an awesome God. Even through this crucial time, he's still the only one that can keep us. Oh, hallelujah. We bless you. We magnify you. Hallelujah. We worship you. We lift our hands and give you glory. We don't want nobody else but you, God.
I don't want a form of godliness. I want God. All I ever wanted was God. And I don't want to give him second best. I want God. All I ever wanted was God.
Hey. I don't want a form of godliness.
I want God.
All I ever wanted was God.
Yes, Lord.
And I don't want to give him.
I don't want to give a second best.
I want God. God.
God right now.
I want God. I want.
Yes, God.
God. Yes, just God. We need you, oh God. We need you, oh God.
We can't make it without you. Hey, we can't move without you. It's because of you we live and we move and we breathe. Because it's all of you that we need.
I want God. I want God.
Even when you sit in your lonely time, sing this to yourself.
I want God.
Even when you feel like you're depressed, say
I want God.
Man is trying to commit suicide. I want him. Hey, I want him. Hey, I want God. Cause I'm the head and not the tail. I'm a crown and I'm a knee.
Hey, good morning. Thank you for joining in with the NMC Worship Experience. Listen, I just wanted to come to you all. This morning, our setup is going to be something phenomenal. It's going to be a little bit different, but I pray and hope that you are empowered and you get something from God through this sermon that we're going to do through conversation. So again, thank each and every one of you for tuning in for the worship experience. Those of you who serve with us locally and those of you that are with us virtually, again, every week we're appreciative for anyone that takes time out to worship God with us on Sunday mornings. But listen, we just really want to just tune in and thank God for the media ministry. Thank God for our praise and worship team and all of those who work behind the scenes. Thank God for Lady Baker and all of our families and all of our leadership team and everyone that just plays a part of the New Mount Calvary Church family. But listen, I don't want to hold you no longer than about 2 hours a day. Give me 2 hours and we'll be done. But I have my good brother and my friend with me. We're going to have a conversation this Sunday morning. And prayerfully that this conversation will be able to impact you. And when you leave this virtual experience, that you will feel better about life. Because we know with this pandemic, post-pandemic, pre-pandemic, during the pandemic, so many things have challenged our faith. It has challenged our families. It's challenged our finances. It's even challenged so many believers that some don't even worship like they used to. Some have not even been in no type of church setting, not even virtually or locally. So we just want to talk about a few things biblically, talk about a few things and be transparent and prayerfully that it will impact you and lead you to a better discipleship in following Jesus Christ. So I'm not going to hold you no longer than, like I said, give me 2 hours and we'll be done. But I'm going to let my brother introduce himself.
Good morning, family. Of course, I'm Pastor Aaron Jones, the third pastor, teacher of Mount Nebo Baptist Church and Life Center, located in Thomasville Heights community area, 1025 McDonald Boulevard, Atlanta, Georgia. located right across the street from the world famous Starlight Movie Theater. And so if you know anything about Atlanta or you've been in Atlanta for any amount of time, I think you would know where our location is. And so, man, I'm super excited, to be here with one of my closest friends and brother, Pastor Quinn Baker, and of course, the New Mount Calvary church family. It's good to be with you, man. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Hey, man, I appreciate you. We're going to dive into this because I know that if not this year, last year, one of the two, you started a series or you gave a theme for your church,
right.
Faith Forward, Moving Forward. Just talk about how God led you to that theme and what points have you been really given to your congregants about moving forward, and what does God say about faith and moving forward?
Well, here's the thing, man. God gave me that. If any of you know my story as it relates to Mount Nebo, I was the predecessor of a man, the successor. Let me take that back. I succeeded Pastor A.J. McMichael, who pastored Mount Nebo for 50 years. And one of the things that God spoke to me as it relates to having the church to focus upon 2 years ago when I got there was move forward, fast forward or forward progress or focus forward, that our focus was to be moving forward. I really didn't understand it at that particular time. And a lot of things that God gave me during that time when I first got there, 2.5-3 years ago, I understand it now, because when I got there, we were not in a pandemic. And so I was looking at the whole focus forward as just simply taking the church, from one era to the next, if you will, just moving it forward. But now, being in this pandemic and even post-pandemic, I see it even more clearer now that we as pastors, we as leaders, have to lead our people forward, that we have to keep them focused forward. And so, man, honestly, God has really, really been dealing with me a lot as it relates to this whole post-pandemic and moving forward. How do we move forward? Because, we're still in the throes of the pandemic, but we got to move forward. Mm. And so I think this conversation is good because God has given me a lot of principles and a lot of things to help the body of Christ, in moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
It's time to go forward. And one of those scriptures that I use, if you have your Bible, is Philippians 3, where the Apostle Paul, one of my favorite passages in the Bible, the Apostle Paul, he's in jail, he's awaiting to die. And he makes, Quinn, one of the most powerful statements I ever heard. And the reason why I feel like it's powerful is because of the situation that he's in.
Mm-hmm.
He's in prison. He's awaiting to die, and he says, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before." Then he says, "I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." And so that was originally, man, honestly, the foundation of this whole focus forward that God gave me. And I really, really began to look at that passage, and I realized what the Apostle Paul was saying. When you study, we do a word study of what he says, "Brother, I count not myself to have apprehended." That word apprehended is so key, because the word apprehended is translated to mean capture, seize, or to take.
Mm.
And so here he is, he's in a prison, he's waiting to die, and he says, he admits that he still not where God would have him to be, that he's yet to capture, he's yet to seize, he's yet to take. And so he says, "I've gotten to this place where I'm not where God, I haven't reached my destiny as of yet. And so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to forget about the past and I'm going to reach forth. I'm going to press forward." And so, of course, forgetting about the past, man, has a lot to do with, forgetting about past sins, forgetting about past mistakes, forgetting about past situations.
Right.
And he says, "I'm going to press." That word press is translated to mean systematically chase.
Mm-hmm.
He says, "I'm going to strive after with intensity what God has for me." And so, as we continue to navigate and move through this whole post-pandemic era, we have to be focused forward, forgetting about the past, realizing, number one, I've yet to arrive.
Right.
I've yet to reach the place where God will have me to be. And so I'm going to forget about my past. I tell people all the time, man, I'm not going to allow my past to hurt me. I'm not going to allow my past to harm me. But I will only allow my past to help propel me to where God will have me to be. I can't get stuck in the past. You know, that's one of the problems, you know, in a lot of times, especially in the church. I mean, let's be real, man. We get so stuck, you know, in the past when God is saying, you got to systematically chase. You got to strive out the with intensity what's in front of you. Because greater is, I got more in front of me than I got behind me. And so, you know, the whole, that's really where it came from. Just allowing, or rather trying to get our people to see that even though we've accomplished a whole lot in the past, there's much more in front of us than it is behind.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. And I like when you talk about focusing. That word focus is strong.
Oh yeah, man.
I think I you know, just with some of the experiences that I've had, you know, passing through this pandemic, was trying to keep people focused.
That's the struggle. That's the struggle.
How do you gotta keep everybody focused? How do you keep them engaged? You know, and at the end of the day, it's kind of like Noah having to be on an ark. He had to steer something he had never been on before. He had to push an ark. Nothing had been done like this before. And he is, Noah, you got to get this thing moving. So now we found ourselves as leaders. And see, you've been in these two different places. That's why I want to kind of get you to, you know, talk about this just a little, you know. You've been in a rural environment. You've been in smaller ministry environments. You've been in a comfortable ministry environment. You've been in the city environment. For you, what is the difference in focuses, or is the focus still the same no matter where you are?
Well, I think the focus is still the same, but it's method, if you will. Because our focus must always be on Christ. It must always be, you know, on the ministry and the reason why the church was established, period. So we can never take our focus off of that, but we have to shift how we do things. And that's the struggle, in keeping people focused on the mission and the vision, but helping them or getting them to understand that you have to shift. I like to put it this way, man. Jesus never changed his message, but he changed his method. And if we can get people to understand that the message stays the same, but the methodology or the method may have to change, you know, that's the greatest struggle. And so our focus, we have to stay, you know, because even with this pandemic, we've all had to pivot, you know. Like you said, you try to steer something that you've never steered before. Nobody is an expert on this because nobody has gone through it. So the struggle for you and I, as we've talked many times, as you just stated, was to keep people focused. And so we keep, we try to keep people focused on the mission and the vision of the church, but changing how we go about it. Because the reality is, and it kind of goes back to something you, you asked me a few minutes ago with the whole focus forward. You know, I had one way of wanting to do what I wanted to do at Mount Nebo and moving them forward, you know, 2.5-3 years ago, but when the pandemic hit, bro, all that changed. You know, the method had to change because, and I'll give you an example. You know, at one time it was all about trying to get people to come to the building. And so, you know, we come up with strategies to get people to come to the building. That's changed. Now it's about methods to get people just to engage online. So, you know, I think the focus, the foundational focus is still the same, but our methods change.
That's good. That's good. Because I mean, I believe that this pandemic, I know you and I have had, you know, offline conversations, man. We've had it.
That y'all don't want to hear.
Y'all
don't want to hear that.
We've had some offline conversations, man. And bringing, like I said, we want to be transparent, you know, bringing that through. We're good. We're good as leaders. We're putting the focus, like helping others to stay focused. What have been, what you've done to help you to stay focused, you to stay healthy.
Man, let me tell you something. He said we can be transparent. I'll be honest with you. You got to walk away sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we've talked about this because, again, you can get so inundated and so caught up, like you said, in trying to keep other people focused that, you know, you lose yourself in that.
Mm.
And, you know, man, at the end of the day, we're human.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we got this calling and we got this anointing and you know, we hear from God and all this stuff. But at the end of the day, we're human.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't take time, and I use the word walk away, I'm not saying, you know, throw in the towel quit or you say, man, forget, bump this, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Offline conversation, it'll be another word, right?
Because tomorrow I get a text message.
We ain't talking about walking away where we just throw in the towel, but I'll change it. You got to pull back.
Mm-hmm.
You got to pull back sometimes so that you as a leader, myself as a leader, and any other leader that may be watching, so you can recalibrate, so that you can rejuvenate yourself. Mm-hmm. And so you got to pull away, take a break, man, go on vacation, do whatever you like to do, you know, to bring relaxation and cause you to recalibrate, because burnout is real.
Man,
it is. Especially during this, when you are trying to navigate through something that you've never gone through, I've never gone through, nobody else that we know of has gone through, you know, and you trying to be the best leader that you can be, and then outside of that, you have a life outside of the church,
right?
You know, that includes your family, your children.
Absolutely.
If you're bivocational, a job, that stuff, man, can, you know, wow. I mean, you got a whole bunch of people pulling at you. It don't matter how big or small your ministry is.
Mm-hmm.
You got people pulling at you. You're trying to set up things to keep people together, keep people focused.
Right.
The way that I have been able to stay focused, man, I pull away. You know, I pull away. Some days I don't go to the office. Some Sundays I didn't preach. You know, I get on the plane and go out of town, or I sit at the crib and just chill. Because, I mean, you know, whatever it takes for you to stay focused, you got to.
Right.
Sometimes a lot of church folk don't like to hear this because they expect Reb to be around all the time, but Reb got to, you know, he got to pull away as well. And I encourage, while we're there, you know, I encourage all of who are listening, especially if you're a part of, if you're under Pastor Baker's leadership, you know, October is clergy or pastors, you know, appreciation month.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the best ways, ladies and gentlemen, you know, you as a parishioner can keep your pastor encouraged and focused is by encouraging him. Because we spend so much time pouring into other people.
Absolutely.
It is very, very rare that we are poured into. And I'm not talking about from other preachers, because, yeah, we can sit out and listen to each other preach or somebody else preach or teach.
Right.
But it's nothing like when your people pour back into you.
Absolutely.
And it ain't got to be nothing deep, you know. It's just, Pastor, I appreciate you. Pastor, you're doing a good job. It ain't got to be nothing deep.
Right.
You know? But I stay focused, man, by pulling away.
Mm-hmm.
I'll pull away in a minute, man.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I feel burnt out. No, I'm going to pull away. Oh, yeah. Most definitely.
Yeah, because there's been some times I call you and I'm like, man, I'm sitting here in McDonough, Georgia.
All right. And I tell you, man, close that stuff up and go do something, man. Let's go do something.
Yeah. Spinning. Because, man, one thing that people don't get a chance to see, unless they work with you close,
unless
they're your spouse, unless they're your kids, unless they really work, they have no idea the burden and the pressure that comes with pastors.
No idea at all.
Let me make sure I'm playing this. Pastors who are committed to what they're doing.
Right.
When you love what you do and you're committed to what you do, it can take a toll on you. So that you're right, that burnout and pulling away, just getting a chance to you know, get somewhere where you can, like you said, recalibrate, get yourself together. I got a chance to ask, we laughed about this because I had to, and change comes.
Right.
If we don't embrace change, then you're going to get left. There's a passage in the Bible that says, and the sons of Issachar, they understood the times.
Right.
When you don't understand the times, you'll get left behind.
Every time.
So what happens is change took place. So about a couple of weeks ago, I got a chance to celebrate your past anniversary with you, man.
Yeah.
Phenomenal,
wow,
man.
Wow.
Phenomenal. And what I wanted to speak on about that was, it was different for your congregation.
Yep.
It was different for some of them. They were used to doing certain things, which don't make it wrong.
Right.
But change don't make it wrong either. So
right.
There was something that you did, man, that I think that the people of God need to hear when it comes to not just leadership, but marriages, period. At the end, when you was giving your remarks, you talked about the things that you went through to get to Mount Nebo.
Right, right.
And how important it was from the support of your wife, Tam,
oh, yeah.
My sister,
oh, yeah.
And your children. Talk about, man, when it comes to this faith movement, how important it is for family to support one another.
Oh, it's important because, as you said, change.
Mm-hmm.
We are all going through this change.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't matter if you're a pastor, you know, if you're a business owner, we've all had to pivot. We've all had to make adjustments. And, you know, trying to pivot and trying to make adjustments can be difficult.
Mm.
But one of the things that I believe is that in the process of going through any type of change or you're pivoting in any situation, you may start to discover new things about yourself and new things about people that you are connected or attached with.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times, man, you know, when you start moving around and you're getting out of a comfort zone,
mm-hmm.
your support system is key.
Mm.
Because a lot of times for us as pastors, man, you know, sometimes we can act as though we kind of schizophrenic.
Mm.
And, you know, whereas a lot of people around us really don't know what's going on, you know, it's like we doing one thing, thinking one thing, and the support of a spouse,
mm.
the support, you know, in a marriage is critical.
Mm.
I think one of the keys in being able to support and help your spouse go through that change is always understanding and remembering what they're called to do.
Mm.
I mean, I think that's so key.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my wife and my kids, man, you know, they understand the call that's on my life.
Wow.
They understand that, and with this call, you know, there comes a lot of change.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, changing, because I went from one location, if you will, all the way to the next, dealing with a whole type of different group of people, you know, dealing with another type of group of people. And, you know, and I think too, man, my folks, and I say my folks, my wife and my kids, they just realize, man, I'm not tied to, I like being different.
Mm.
I like doing different stuff. I love trying different things.
Mm-hmm.
And so the support as we go through it, man, is so, so critical, especially, you know, if you're gonna stay together, because you start tapping into creativity.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you start really, one of the things the pandemic has allowed all of us to do is to explore or pursue a lot of things that we've always wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that once, you know, the spouses and the kids really understand, for instance, this has always been a dream of mine, or, you know, I'm gonna step out here and do this. You know, we going through this change. It's just, again, I go back to, man, understanding that call, man.
Mm.
Understanding what God has ultimately anointed you to do.
Mm.
And I mean, yeah, it gets rough and it
right.
gets challenging, right. but I mean, it's a part of it. Long as we make up our mind that we in this together,
mm-hmm.
you know, we may not agree all the time, but
we
in this thing together.
Oh.
And, you know, we going to make it work.
Man, my wife agree all the time. I don't know what you're talking about.
Well, bro,
Sister Baker, we agree. I got you.
Well, bro, you got a perfect marriage there.
Bishop behind the scenes. Bishop, you and your wife agree all the time, don't you?
Yeah. I don't. Me and my wife don't. So, y'all got a perfect marriage. We don't.
Man,
yeah.
Far from perfect, man. And you know, man, I tell you, man, there are some people who will probably, you know, watch this more and say, hey, I don't have the husband. I don't
okay.
have the wife. You're talking about focusing forward. You're talking about keeping faith. I've been going through a pandemic. I've been lonely. I've been stressed out. What's your encouragement to them, man? That person that says, you know, the one thing, because some people, unfortunately, man, some people really, the one thing they had outside of work and everything else was going to church on Sunday morning.
Yeah, yeah.
So that person now is saying, I mean, I don't have that no more. I enjoy this virtual, but and it's sad. Now this is a whole nother subject, but that's why it's bad to make church your girlfriend or your boyfriend. But anyway, that's a whole nother conversation.
Right, right.
But what is your encouragement to the person that says, I'm tired, I'm lonely, I'm doing this by myself, I want to lose faith in God, I don't see God blessing me. I've been looking at social media, even in the pandemic, folks getting married, even in the pandemic, folks getting new jobs.
Wow. Yeah.
Where do faith fit in for me? I've been having faith.
Well, here's the reality. Number one, if social media is your issue or your problem, get off of social media.
Come on, Doc.
I mean, if you know, people are going to only post what they want you to see.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, and so that's the first thing. You got to get off of it. Matter of fact, Pastor Baker, when we first met, he used to always call Facebook fake book. And that's the first thing. The second thing is you cannot stop trusting God. Mm-hmm. And I know that's like easier said than done, but let me help you with this real quick. And I don't know how much time we got left, but let me help you with this.
Okay.
Exodus chapter 14 has become very important to me, if I should say. Exodus chapter 14, it's a very familiar story, but it's so many nuances and so many things in that story as it relates to moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
You know, since we're talking about this whole subject about faith and moving forward, that's one of the most powerful stories in the Bible as it relates to moving forward. Exodus chapter 14, very, very popular. Everybody knows it. It's the story of when Israel's finally escaped, you know, if you will, Pharaoh and the Egyptians, and they are camped out at the Red Sea.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you read the story, the Bible teaches that several things happen. Number one, there is a sea in front of them,
mm-hmm.
because here they are. They had every intent on moving forward when they left Egypt. And now, you know, they're facing a major challenge,
mm-hmm.
which is in and of itself that whenever, you know, you decide to move forward, you're going to face some challenges. Whether you're doing it by yourself, whether you're doing it with or without a spouse, you're going to face some challenges.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, they got this problem where there is a sea in front of them,
mm-hmm.
but then there are soldiers behind them. Because the Bible teaches that when the Pharaoh found out that, hey, these folks done got away, you know, he saddled up his chariots and all that stuff, and
mm-hmm.
they going after, you know, getting slaves back.
Uh-huh.
So the problem is they got a sea in front of them.
Mm.
They got, you know, soldiers behind them.
Mm-hmm.
They got terrains on the side of them. So it's like, what do I do? It's almost like Israel has reached a place where they're stuck because they don't know what to do. But here is the beauty in the story. There's a sea in front of them. There are soldiers behind them. But there is a savior in between them, in between the children of Israel and the soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Bible says that when they got there, and of course we know the story, you know, they start complaining to Moses. Mm-hmm. They start blaming Moses. That's right. A whole nother sermon in and of itself. You know,
yeah.
Everybody want to blame the leader. They start blaming Moses. Then they start predicting their own demise. You know, Moses, we told you, just leave. You could have left us alone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you could have left us in Egypt to die.
There, right?
We wanted to stay back.
Yep.
And so I'm glad you said that, because one of the nuances in that story is it's not meant for you to go back. Just because you got a sea in front of you and soldiers behind you, the challenge is, how do I move forward? Because
mm-hmm.
nowhere in the Word of God does God ever tell us to go backwards.
Come on, man.
Backwards seems comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
It seems, well, I'm just going to go back to what I'm used to. Because in essence, that's what they were saying.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to go back to what I was used to.
Right.
And what God is saying is, get out of Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I freed you. I heard you moan, I heard you cry. I've given you what you want.
Mm.
Now it's left up to you. So after they got through with all that complaining, man, the Bible says that God told Moses, why are you whining to me?
Mm.
That's a message to every leader. Why are you crying?
Come on.
He's already told you what to do. He said, tell the people, go forward.
Mm.
But how are we going to go forward? There's a sea in front of us.
Come on,
so we step over the water, we might drown. But he said, go forward. The beauty is that God repositions his presence. Because when they were in Etham, he supplied them with a pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. And they were to follow the cloud.
Come on,
the cloud in front of them represented God leading them. But behind them, it represented him protecting them.
Come on, man.
And so as you and I, you know, move forward, I gotta, no matter how you doing it, whether you feel like you're doing it by yourself, or even if you, now this gets tricky, you got a spouse, but you're still doing it by yourself. You know, you gotta first, you gotta realize, number one, your potential. You have what it takes to do it. You keep the faith, you move forward by realizing your own potential. Don't look at nobody else's potential. You have what it takes to move forward. Secondly, you gotta recognize God's promises.
Come on, man.
Whatever God has promised us, he's not gonna back up off of it. He's not gonna renege on it. The promise that God made to Israel and Moses was in Exodus chapter number 6, where he told, he says, I've heard their groaning. I've heard their complaining. He says, I have come down to deliver them. God did not bring you to the point where you are to leave you. So I got to realize his promise, but then I got to rely on his presence. I got to understand that his presence he has repositioned himself. This pandemic, and this is the beauty in this whole story. This pandemic has brought many of us out of places of bondage. It has freed us. We've had the opportunity to sit and, man, you know, we were in lockdown to realize and tap into our creativity.
Come on, man.
And yeah, we faced some challenges, but no matter what the challenge will be, God is still with us.
Yes, sir.
Even though, you know, he may have repositioned himself.
Come on.
He's still with us. Yeah, he was in front of them, leading them. He led them to where they were. You got it? But now he's behind them, protecting them, saying, look, I got your back.
Come on.
Just keep moving forward. Realize what you got. Then, because if you know the story, the Bible says that God told Moses, he said, man, take that rod that's in your hand.
In your hand.
Lift it up.
Yeah.
And basically watch me work. Now, he repositions himself. You know, he's behind them to protect them, so they can get across the water. Moses used what he has, and boom, we know the story. They you know, walked across on dry land. And so my encouragement to you, man, realize your own potential. You know, keep your faith by realizing your potential. Know that God is still with you. Even though, you know, you may not be able to trace him, you got to still trust him.
Come on, Doc.
Use what you have. I think in anything else, as we continue to navigate through this and moving forward, stop trying to be somebody else. Stop trying to use somebody else's stuff. Use what you have and watch God work, man.
Come on, Doc.
Watch him work.
Come on. Somebody type down that comment field. Faith forward.
Yeah, faith forward.
Focus,
man.
Focus forward.
Focus forward.
I'm loving it. I'm loving it because, you know, last week I got an opportunity to preach on the widowed woman.
Right,
Who had two sons left. She had two sons left. And I'm just listening to you, God telling Moses, use what's in your hand.
Yep. Same thing, you know, with the widow.
With the widow, what you got. I got a jar of oil. Use the jar of oil. Jesus told disciples, hey, what do you got? There's a boy out here with two fish and five barley loaves.
It's like what you got.
God always leaves us with something that says, just use what you got. Once you use what God has given you, he's going to do the multiplying.
Yep.
That's that faith part of it. But what happens is, it's what you talked about. We're so focused on seeing faith from a reversal side.
Wow.
Have faith in it if I know how it's going to turn out.
And that's not faith.
That's not faith, man.
That's not faith.
Most of us, that's how, you know, we date like that.
Right.
We think like that. We do our finance like that. If I'll give to you, God, if I know how next week is going to look. I'll give to you, God, if I know how next 6 months. That is not faith.
Faith
is taking what you already have, saying, God, even when I can't trace you, I trust you. So I'm going to give you what, and here's the thing, anything that God has given you, it was already in his plans to see what you were going to do with it anyway.
Wow, I love it.
Moses just end up with a rod.
Right.
That was in God's plans for it to end up in his hands. Man, listen, what God has done for each and every one of us is put something in our plans, put something in our destiny for it to end up in our hands. Now, here's the thing. It's the faith piece Pastor Ben talk about. What are you going to do?
What are you going to do with it?
With it.
Yep.
Like I said last week, God said, he said to me when I was, you know, preaching that message, you know, Elijah didn't want the woman to focus on her losing her husband.
Right, right.
He wanted her to focus on the oil that she had left.
Wow.
I spent a lot of time, Pastor. I spent a lot of my life worrying about what I lost.
Wow. Wow.
What I didn't do in 2010 when I didn't get this completed. And God is saying, fool.
Right.
When are you going to focus on what you have left?
Because the reality is, and I don't mean to cut you off,
man,
but the reality is sometimes you got to lose the game.
Ooh.
And a lot of times, you know, like you said, we get so caught up in what we've lost.
Mm.
And then once we finally focus on what we have left, we realize that what we got left is better than what we lost.
Man, come on.
Even though it may not be as much, but what I got left, if I take what I have left and use it,
man,
it's better than what I lost, and I'll get more out of it.
Yes, sir.
You know, especially, you know, and I'll piggyback off of it when it comes to money.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the challenge in this pandemic has been loss of hours on jobs. You know, we've had to probably spend more money doing things. You know, cost of stuff has gone up. You know, man, you go to the grocery store now, I mean, man, you know, chicken seems like it's $50 now.
Man.
And, you know, the challenge is, you know, how do I navigate through this financially, if you will, because I've already lost so much. I don't know what's going to happen with my job. And this is where the faith piece comes in. But I'm challenged.
Mm.
I still got to treat God right with what I have.
Come on, Doc.
Yeah, I may have lost some hours. I may have lost some money. I may have even lost a job, layoff, furlough, whatever the case may be. But I'm still challenged to treat God right with what I have. I'm going to put it this way. Even though you're facing a challenge, God's command does not change.
Come on, man.
And you know what? For all you church folk that's watching or unchurch, hear me again. I'm going to say it again. I may face a challenge.
Type that down, y'all.
But his command does not change.
Woo.
Because that's where faith comes in.
Mm.
Can I obey his command
even
in the midst of this challenge? Because, man, listen, the reality is some people have pulled back, especially financially, because like you said, I don't know what next week gonna look like.
Mm-hmm.
I don't even know if I'm gonna have a job. Yeah, I don't know it, but what I do know is this, God is obligated.
Mm.
He's obligated to come through for me when I obey him.
Come on, man.
He is obligated.
Woo.
It don't matter what he's obligated.
Mm-hmm.
If he tells me in this season of even, you know, may have lost some finances or going through some financial struggles, if he tells me that I'll open the windows of heaven for you and pour you out blessings that you won't have room enough to receive, all you got to do is give me your tithe and your offering.
Mm.
You know, tithe is a tenth. Tithe is the debt that we owe. Offering is the seed that we sow. If he promised that and I obey and I do it, he has to come through for me.
Come on, man.
Now, I ain't got to know how. He has to do it.
Come on, man.
And I place emphasis upon that because that's why many people miss it. He has to do it. You know the Bible. God's not a man that he should not lie. When does he ever lie? When does he ever pull back off of what he promised?
Mm.
He has to do it.
Come on,
and
man.
So the challenge is, hey, I got to obey God in this season.
Come on.
I got to obey God. Look, I don't know who I'm talking to, but, you know, you may be going through some financial challenges. Listen to me. The answer is not for you trying to go out and find a whole bunch of jobs. It's obey God. Obey God with what you already have.
Come on, man.
And watch him multiply.
Woo.
Listen, I'm a living witness. If you obey God with what you have, you know, it could be a small amount or whatever. You treat God right with your resources. You give him your tenth and your offering, because the Bible says that you rob him, because a lot of people get that mixed up.
Mm-hmm.
They think they big time because they give God 10%. That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm still considered a God robber when I go that extra mile, if you will, and put that seed in the ground.
Offering. That's right.
Because that offering really determines the blessing that comes on my life.
Mm-hmm.
You got it? So the challenge is, obey God with what you have.
Come on, man. Come on.
Obey him with what you have. You know, I challenge you. You know, go above and beyond.
Yeah.
You know, you're tithing off. You know, Pastor Quinn didn't ask me to do it, but there's so much as we continue to pivot. you know, through this pandemic and trying to lead people, you know, with all the changes that are going on, you know, ministry costs. Let's just be honest, man. Ministry costs with what we are trying to do as leaders and pastors, be innovative, you know, keep your safety, you know, if you will, as a number one concern, ministry costs.
It does, man.
And your financial support, your seed, your meeting the challenge, not only blesses the ministry, but it's going to turn around, it's going to bless you. For instance, I said it earlier, and I'm going to go back to this for just a few moments. At two and a half, three years ago, the challenge was, how do we get people to come to our building?
Right, right.
That was the challenge. Now, the challenge is, how do we use our buildings to engage people equip people?
Come on.
Well, guess what? You gotta make changes to it. You know, whether it's lights, whether it's, you know, cameras, whether it's carpet, whether it's painting, whatever it is, you got to make some changes to it.
Yes, sir.
Now, I think you and I were talking about overnight, we all became televangelists. You know, it was like everybody TV preacher.
Everybody.
Overnight, but guess what? Camera equipment costs. Lights cost. We were thrust into this out of nowhere. And, you know, financial support definitely is needed. Because if you want your ministry to be on the cutting edge of what's going on and continue, you know, to help you navigate with content and with, you know, with everything, you know, that we're trying to do to keep people engaged, man, financial support is definitely needed. You got it? And so even though, you know, I tell my people, even though you may not be in the sanctuary with me, you know, just because you can't come to church on Sunday, God has provided so many ways for you to still be able to support your church, not only through clapping your hands, worshiping, praising, and singing, but also through giving. And so I challenge every individual out there, you know, let's help keep, you know, this ministry and other ministries thriving. Let's help keep them going. You know, I challenge everybody that's listening to me, you know, get your smart device. I don't, you know, I guess the bishop of
videography
will put the different ways to give to New Mount Calvary on the screen. But I challenge, sow an additional seed of $50. Pastor Quinn asked me, that's just what I feel. Sow an additional, whatever, whether it's Givelify, what is it, PayPal, Cash App, if you still believe in the old school system, mailing it in, if you still believe, because I got a whole lot of my members, man, they ain't with the online giving. They ain't with it. And I'm cool with that. They ain't with it.
Yes,
look, if you like one of my, you ain't with it, okay, cool. The mail system still works. Or if you just want to get out of your car on a nice, beautiful day and take it by the church, I want every individual on the sound of my voice. The Bible says, but this I say, he who sows sparingly shall reap also sparingly. He who sows bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Let every man give not grudgingly of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. Now here's the promise, and God is able to make all grace. That word grace is translated to mean favor. Favor is when God raises up somebody to use their power, their ability, and their influence to help you. Let me tell you something. During this pandemic, as we continue to go through it, and I thank God, I just heard just the other day, they were saying that, you know, the numbers are going down as it relates to the virus. We thank God for that, but the reality is, you know, this whole virus ain't going nowhere. I think we're going to have to learn how to live with it. You got it? And so as we move in what we believe closer into coming out of the pandemic, but still dealing with the coronavirus itself,
yeah,
I'm gonna need some favor. I'm gonna need for God to raise up somebody to use their power, their ability, and their influence to help me. But my seed triggers that. That's why we miss it. My seed triggers that.
Right.
And so when you put that seed in the ground and you release your faith for the favor of God, watch how God begins to release people in your life to help you do whatever it is you're trying to do, whether it's a business, whether it's a new job, whether it's a new home, whether it's a new vehicle. Watch how God begins to release people. And so I'm challenging you. You know, I know it's on the screen. you know, sow an additional seed of it. Wow, I got to pay bills next week. See, that's where faith comes in. Trust God. Mm-hmm. The man of God is giving you a challenge. God's challenges does not change. You know, you pay your tithe, your 10%. Let's go above and beyond that. Mm-hmm. Put that seed in the ground and watch God move. Because even though I'm faced with a financial challenge, his command has not changed.
And I like that. I like that.
His command has not changed.
Bishop gonna give me some t-shirts made off of that. Listen. Hey, NMC, I pray. Y'all do me a favor. Shout down in that comment field. Put some claps. Put some hearts. Let me know that you appreciated what God allowed for us to do. When we're talking about pivot, that word pivot, moving from one spot to another. Here it is. 2 years ago, we wasn't having platforms like this.
Right.
We weren't even, we didn't have enough. We weren't courageous enough.
Right. We weren't even thinking about it.
But now we're able to have platforms that can reach other individuals. Here's the thing. Delivery comes in different ways.
Right.
I can order something and they ask me, which way do you want this come? FedEx, you want it to come by UPS, right. You want it to come by USPS. It can be delivered in different ways.
Right.
The word of God is being delivered in different ways. We cannot focus on just one way of delivering God's word.
Right.
He talked about, hey, the traditional way of coming by the church and giving. We don't want to ignore that, but we don't want to ignore the people that say, hey, I'd rather stay home and just give by Cash App. Right. I'd rather watch it virtually. It was Dr. Maurice Watson who said church has become an option and virtual church has become the new norm.
Yep.
So people now are saying, I'd rather stay home. But whatever it is, be convicted by God that you're doing it. Don't do it just because somebody else say, well, I'm going to stay home. No, be convicted by God that you're staying home for your personal reasons.
Right.
Okay. Hey, I pray that you were blessed by something that was said.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Today, I enjoyed myself.
Oh, yeah.
And Bishop, no, when I enjoy myself, it only goes higher. for the naysayers, I won't even entertain naysayers this morning. God gave me this vision, and I believe that somebody was blessed
this. Oh, yeah.
And guess what? One thing me and my brother always talk about before we leave, if your ministry is not attractive enough that another ministry says, hey, we need to try something like that. Y'all ain't really doing nothing.
Exactly.
Ministry should be attractive to where another leader can say, hey, you know what? We need to think outside the box. Yep. Me and my brother, we are always encouraging each other. Hey, man, yeah, I'm going to try something. I'm trying this too. I'm going to try. Hey,
absolutely.
Because like you said, once again, we're like Noah. We've been given this task to build something we ain't never built for.
Never.
We don't have nothing to compare. We don't have nothing to compare it to.
No blueprint, no nothing.
We can't say back into 1900 when this happened the
last time. Right. We just got to trust God. Listen to the voice of God.
Yes. And so listen, I hope y'all took some nuggets. Listen, I hope y'all have a great Sunday. This has been, I've been blessed. I didn't take notes. But I'm good with mental notes. There's some things I'm going to go back and write it down because, man, bro, you gave us some nuggets.
I appreciate it, man.
You gave us some nuggets.
Man. God be praised, man.
Man, Mount Nebo is blessed, man.
Wow. I'm blessed.
Your wife and children, they're
blessed, man.
I mean, you all, I call you my big brother.
Yeah.
I'm not going to call nobody my big brother that I can't look up to.
Right. I'm honored, man.
And many people know how close me and my pastor, Pastor Spence, was.
Yeah.
Very close. And unknowingly to me, in the midst of hurting, in the midst of trying to figure things out, me and my brother became closer.
Oh, yeah,
Because I needed that voice, that person who can take me away from all the, just the preacher talk.
Right.
And talk to me as a man.
There you go.
Man,
all the preacher talk. Right.
Friend and brother. Yeah. And say, hey, Quinn, you know, tell you when you're screwed up. If your friends will ever tell you when you're screwed up, you ain't got no good friends. Man, New Mount Caravan, I love you. I'm praying for you. I'm with you. You've seen the different ways to give. Please get in contact with us, info@caravanland.org. We need to hear from you if it's any way. We have different things that's put together. Our NMC Cares team, they're getting ready to prepare for Christmas, doing things for the women's shelter. To all of our men, I want y'all to join us November the 20th for Man Cave. Man Cave, it's going to be wonderful. It's going to be a TG Event Studios. We're going to be talking about some good stuff. fellas. So you'll see the flyer on the screen. Get in touch with Minister Dewberry. Man Cave is going to be off the chain. It's going to be a brunch. We're going to have food, music, which is going to be brethren's sharpening each other. Yeah. You wear your favorite jersey, so I know most of the people going to have on Dallas Cowboys.
Cowboys, you know, in the house. How about them Cowboys, baby? Yes, sir.
Hey, somebody on the Cowboys been paying their tithes and offering. God is showing favor.
How about them Cowboys, baby? Stop hating out there now. Stop hating.
Listen, I pray that you have a great Sunday. Listen, let us get ready to leave out. I'm going to ask our guest pastor to pray us out. And listen, I will see y'all next week. But, man, I pray that you was blessed by today's sermon through conversation.
Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we're grateful and thankful for our time together. Thank you for Pastor Quinn, and thank you for the New Mount Calvary family. Yes. God, thank you for innovation. Thank you for trend setting. Thank you for all the wonderful ideas and wisdom that you poured into his leadership team and himself, oh God, as they continue to navigate through these unprecedented times. God, we pray now that you continue to pour out wisdom, knowledge, and your anointing upon his life. Bless his family, bless his wife, his children.
Thank you,
and God, we pray that you continue to shine your light and pour your anointing upon even his church family. God, we pray for those who watch us in virtual land. We thank you, dear God, for every individual who decided to join us during this time. Thank you, oh God, that even though this was a different format, that your word has gone forth and has been received.
Yes, God.
And God, we thank you that lives will be changed, that people will be blessed. God, as we prepare to log off, as always, it is our prayer that you would never dismiss us from your sight. We thank you that no plague shall come nigh our dwelling place, that you give angels charge over our lives. We shall not die, but we shall live to declare your word.
Yes, sir.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Love y'all.
Hey, take care. Peace. We love you.
Come on, put your hands together as we get ready to leave today. I hope you enjoyed the message. I hope God blessed you. I want you to put your hands together and dance a little bit with me. Come on. To the left. To the right. Come on. Hey. To the left. To the right. Come on. Take it back. To the left. Come on. Take it back. Come on. To the left. Listen. If it had, cannot be for